So on behalf of TVS Training and Services, this is Krishna Kumar here, and I have Mr. Thangaraj with me. So he's going to take you through the entire session for this this particular topic. So before start, my great thanks to KCE for this wonderful support. So I believe it is a continuous activities happening for KCE. So the probably for TVS Training and Services is the first time we are connecting with KCE for such a sort of a activities. So before going further, I would like to thank Mr. Krishna and Mr. Muralidharan for leading this entire activity. So thank you so much for your support from KCE, sir. Thank you so much. Myself Krishna Kumar here. I'm going to take you through this corporate profile presentation about TVS Training and Services. So this is the first slide which you look at. So you can see the different activities of the company. So the company is into sourcing, training, and placements. Sourcing doesn't mean anything. So it's just to find out candidates, to get the candidates into the training platform. So we train candidates, and we also do the placement related activities. If you look at the right bottom logos, so we are the partner to National Skill Development Corporation. We do a lot of training activities with regards to the government funded program. So we are partnered with NSDC for certain activities. So so particularly TVS Training and Services, a TVS group company, and we started in 1997 as a Center for Vocational and Advanced Training Institute. So we progressed as a polytechnic in 2006, and we started serving non-TVS group companies from 2007 onwards. So if you look at 97 to 2006, it's more of a activities which is happening for TVS group of companies. So parallelly, it become a activity which extended to the non-TVS group companies as well. So from 2011 onwards, the company is named as to TVS Training and Services Limited, and we are existing almost for 10 years now. So the vision of the organization is to create technically proficient individuals who meet global standards of excellence towards multiple sectors and domains. So even if you look at the vision statement, it says multiple sectors and domains. So it means, so as a company, we are working with different sectors. So sectors in the sense we work with different, so we work with colleges, we work with industries, we work with bankings and financial institutions, and different other people. So if you look at the domains, we work with manufacturing, engineering, quality, maintenance, electrical, welding, automation, embedded systems, logistics, packing solutions. So, am I audible? Thank you. You can, we are into all these different domains, and we are currently working with about 200 plus enterprises, and we work very closely work with about 25 plus academic institutions. So whatever we do a customized approach to the training. So we don't go with the menu card selling. So we find the customer requirement. So based on the requirement, we do the customized program delivery for the any industry or whichever, let it be industry or college or banking or whatever, let it be. So first we go with the training need analysis, and then we visit their place, we understand their requirement in detail, and we will do the content discussion further, and we go to the client. The clients usually visit to TVS Training and Services premises. So if you've been there for last 20 minutes, you should have seen a couple of videos. So all these videos being shooted at our premises. So that is a sort of a infrastructure we have in Ambattur, Chennai. So I'll take you through a few photographs in the coming slide. So then we will go with the content approval when we will do the staff program delivery, and then next come to the assessments and post program support. So if you look at these divisions, the divisions majorly, the top one is whatever the work we do with industries and corporates. If you go further, we very closely work with engineering colleges and universities to train, certify, and support placement for the students. So even now, we do a lot of training with regards to in terms of e-learning. Apart from e-learning related activities, we are also supporting the 2018-2019 passed out candidates for the placement. So if anybody there in this group with 2020 passed outs, and if you have any friends with or seniors in 2018-19, if they are looking out for placements, so we'll share the email ID at the last slide. You can share across your resumes. We will look into it. If you have any suitable opportunities, definitely we can support you in placements as well. And as mentioned in the first slide, we do a lot of funded training programs for government. And as I mentioned, there is a separate division where we serve banks and financial institutions. So that comes under our next division. And we are also a NEEM partner under AECT, and we do have about 20,000 employees under 24 different companies within the roles of TVS Educational Society. And we also do projects and consulting services for various industries. So this all comes under revisions. If you look at the slide, this is a partial customer list. So I've shown you as 200 customers. So this is just a glimpse of customers we currently work with. If you look at the first two lines, it's more of a TVS Group customers. And if you go below, you can see a lot of automotive OEMs, auto component suppliers, and other different industry suppliers. So it's generally engineering and process oriented training companies we work with. You can see something like Kellogg's, Bosch, and other people also been into this part. And this is a technical training center photographs. So we have two technical training center in Ambattur. This is a center one photograph, and this is the center two photographs. And so apart from this particular webinar, we also do a couple of other webinars calendared for the entire month. So if you look at this entire calendar, we have completed about 14 sessions so far, and we have another 6 sessions which is pipelined from today onwards. So all these sessions will happen normally from 3 to 4. So we will have your contact details. So based on the information we have, we will share all those details to you for email and WhatsApp. And so for any contacts, so for any support and assistance, you can always be in touch with these mobile numbers and email IDs. And I'm Krishna Kumar here. You can be in touch with me in this mobile number or email ID. So whatever the support you require, we will always there to support you. So thank you. And so I request participants to keep yourself on the mute so that the session will go smooth. So I request the host to support us in that regards to take the support from the students as well. So I believe there's a good amount of support coming from the KCEN. So I think the entire session will go smooth, and you'll have a good amount.
Yes, of course.
Yes, sir, please. Is there any queries? Somebody have unmuted for to share something. Is there any queries?
Yes, sir.
Can I continue? Okay, I'll take that as an acceptance. Participants, if you have any queries, please drop your queries in the chat box. So if your audio video is not clear, whatever, let it be. Whatever the queries you have in between the session, please answer please raise your queries, or please answer to the queries which is raised by the trainer at the chat box alone. So please don't unmute yourself so that all of us can be active and learn something by end of the session. So thank you so much. I'm sharing, I'm giving over the session to my trainer. Thank you, Tangraj. Thanks for the support. So I'll stop the screen and leave him to share the screen.
Okay. Good morning. Good morning, one and all. I'm Tangaraj.
Good morning.
Okay, I'm audible, sir. My voice is clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, fine. And the screen is clear, no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Clear.
Okay. So repeating once again, all the participants are requested to mute yourself during the session so that we can have a smooth and interactive session for the whole. So this is my kind request, and the host, please ensure that too. Shall we start? Yes. So I welcome you all on behalf of TVS Training and Services for this 1.5 webinar on the topic role of pneumatics and hydraulics in automation. Yeah. So anybody want any queries? Need any queries? No. Okay. Fine. So this is again the guidelines, remember, please keep yourself mute, every video also off, and whenever there is a chance for any suggestions or discussions, kindly post your answers or suggestions in the chat box. And at the end of the session, we'll have some discussion, so you can post your whatever your answers or whatever your queries in your chat box again. So we are here to answer your questions. So it's a small introduction about me. I am Thangaraj, working here as a senior trainer. For the past 15 years, I have a combined experience in both industries as well as in training sectors. So basically, I'm an electrical engineer and I'm working in TVS Training and Services for more than 10 years. So these are the almost projects handled by me. So I will take care of automation and sections. I conducted training on industrial automation and low-cost automation and pneumatics, hydraulics, PLC, SCADA, HMI for various customers. And the list of customers mentioned here is a part of it. So with this introduction, we are going to the session. Today, the agenda is we are going to discuss about the introduction of automation and major elements in automation. And we are going to discuss about the basic concepts of pneumatic and hydraulics and what is demerits and merits of the systems and basic structure of these two systems and how these systems are implemented in industries with some case studies. This is the whole agenda for the day. In between any queries, you can, if you're not feeling clear, the screen is not clear, please post your suggestion immediately so that we can have a look on it. So I need feedback immediately, okay, sir? Fine. So now we are entering into the session. Yeah. Automation, it is a technical term. So now it's time for a small chat. Please mute yourself, don't unmute. Put your thoughts and suggestion in the chat box. What is automation in your point? So all the participants are requested to share your, thoughts in the chat. You can type in one or two words, not need a complete explanation, not required, just one or two words. What do you know about automation or what is automation in short? I'm awaiting for your reply. Please mute yourself and put the answers in the chat box. Simulations from Rishi. Yes, simulations. Automation is a form of simulation. Good, good, good. Any other response? Mr. Rishi has posted simulations. So yes, it's a part of automation. Very good. From, I don't know the name, 15730. Automation is we give our task to a system. Okay, good, good. A system. It can be a machine or anything. It can be a system. And innovation made for human comfort. Good, human comfort. Or to reduce human effort, good. Self-automation to do, okay. It can do it its own, Arjun Dev. Good, good, reduced human assistance, yeah. Human effort is reduced. Okay. So please ensure to mute yourself. So reduce human assistance, good, good. Good, thanks for your response, thank you. So yes, of course, automation, what you are saying is right. It is a set of measures to reduce or to replace human work. How can we replace human work? So particularly we need some other machines or a technique to substitute for the human. So we are going to reduce or replace the human work with the help of some machines or some technologies for the purpose. What are those technologies we are going to discuss in detail? So where automation is done in industries generally? So there are many areas we are using automation, but these are some of the highlighted areas where in industries the automations are applicable. So first one is storage system, where you can automatically store or retrieve the materials where human cannot access. Material handling for conveying from job or a part from one place to another place. Doing inspections, automatic inspection lines are possible. So in production also for packing, for testing, for lifting, whatever it can be, we are using in production lines and assembly lines like a vehicle assembly, we are using robots for automatic fixing and removal of parts, etc. These are all the some of the major areas where automation is getting used in industries. And automation is done many areas, of course, we saw. It is one of an example, it's a small video. So it is an example of pick and place operation, how these objects are getting picked and placed and what are the particular mechanical movements in this video. You can just have an observe in it. There are some rotational movements, there are some vertical movements, some pick and place movements are all there. So please have a look on it. Thank you. So it is an example of a material storage system. Okay, so just two examples we saw. One is pick and place, another one is a material storage system. And it is a production line example where, yes, excuse me. Yeah, again repeating, kindly mute yourself. So it is an example of a production line system. So it's a particular pen used for insulin. So just have a look, what are the operations happening? It is conveying the pens. So pick and place operations are done, labeling is done. You can see the movements, vertical movement, horizontal movement, rotational movement. So all these options are done by some of the technologies which you're going to see now. One can be a pneumatic or a hydraulic or electrical combined. It can be happen. So there are many elements involved in this operation. You can have a look at that. So to catch hold the glass objects, to pick the glass objects, to rotate it, and to place it, to arrange it, to check it. So all these are done with the help of these elements, which can be a pneumatic or hydraulic or electrical combined with pneumatic and hydraulic with the brain as a PLC. This is some example in industry. So proceeding with this slide. So from these two videos, we can have a small look on that. What are the elements which we are going to be using automation? So one is mechanical. Obviously, we need some clamping, holding, and objects. So we need some basic mechanisms required. Additional to that, we need a pneumatics or hydraulics based on the load or the power required. And to control this pneumatic and hydraulic, we can have additionally electrical controls also. So that is what combination we will say, hybrid technology. Yeah. So this is a very basic example of a pneumatic system. We are all traveling through our buses, normally in city buses. The door open and close are nowadays happened automatically. And how it is happening, some of you may aware, it is happened with the help of our pneumatic system only. It is a small simulation of this door opening and closing system. So if you saw that behind this opening and closing of the door, there are some pneumatic actuators. We will say that as actuators or cylinders working behind. So in this video, you can see there are two cylinders. There are two cylinders which is helped to open these doors, open and close. And in the right side, you are having a particular circuit diagram for that. It is similarly two cylinders which can move forward and reverse. So if you saw, it is a two cylinders moving forward and backward with the help of some additional components like small valves. So this is what a pneumatic system is going to work in the help of doing some basic automations. So whatever the two cylinders is mentioned in the top of the circuit, and the bottom you have some elements which is a symbol of those elements. They are all valves and control elements. And this is what a small example of a pneumatic application in our day-to-day life, and hydraulic application in our day-to-day life. We all saw this heavy vehicle truck which is used for carrying materials and to unload and load materials. What is the science behind this? You can have a look on this. So if you saw this, behind this truck, you are having a hydraulic pump which is going to pump the oil which is used to lift this particular load by extending this cylinder. So the cylinder is lifted with the help of the oil flow which is generated by the pump which is inbuilt inside the vehicle. And this can able to carry a very heavy load. So the load is now, all the materials are unloaded. Again, there is a control element which is available with the driver, and he is going to operate it with the help of that. Again, the oil is going to return to the tank, and meanwhile, subsequently, the cylinder is getting down slowly. So this type of movement is obviously done by hydraulic element, which is an oil. So naturally, it is going to handle with high power application. So these two videos, from this, you can understand that how these pneumatic and hydraulics are involved in our day-to-day life also. So with this, we are going to start with that first topic, pneumatics. So what is a pneumatic? So pneumatic is nothing but it is a fluid mechanism or fluid mechanic system which is going to use compressed air as the medium of power. We need some energy to be transmitted for motion. The energy here is the compressed air to do the automations. generally in industries, we will be using the pressure. I think if you are going to reduce the volume of the gas, the pressure will be obviously increased. And how much is the maximum pressure we can attain? You can attain up to 10 bar or 12 bar, it is no problem. But optimum is the word, very important. Economically and physically compatible range of pressure is 4 to 6 bar. This is a normal range of pressure which is used in most of the industries. The picture shown below is showing you the schematic representation of the pneumatic structure, which is having majorly two parts. One is air production, another one is air consumption. So air production means it is going to take the atmospheric air and it is going to compress it so that we can get the required pressure by reducing the volume of the gas. So we are going to build the pressurized gas and we are going to store the gas and we are going to use the gas. So the creation part is called production and the consuming part is called consumption. We are going to discuss in detail in the upcoming slides. Yeah, the first one we are going to discuss about air production system, which is the left of your screen. So in air production system, majorly they are marking some 10 components. Some 10 components are marked in that. So the component number one is the very obviously compressor, which is going to be like the energy source for your pneumatic system. We also have compressor in our roadside shops, even in the puncture shops. It is going to take the atmospheric air and it is going to compress it. So this next part, to drive this compressor, we need a electrical machine, which is motor. So it will create the mechanical movement by taking the electrical energy. So the motor is the driving element and the compressor is the element to be driven. And from this, we are getting the compressed air, and this compressed air can be controlled also. So all the 24 hours, the compressor need not to be run. So it can take some rest. For that, we need to set a limit at what pressure range it should cut off, at what pressure range it should start again. These type of settings can be done by the element number 3, which is called your pressure switch. And 4 is a check valve. We all know that it is a non-return valve. So which is available, you can see it is, you can see the track in the line, it is available in the entrance of your tank. So it will allow the air to flow into your tank. It will not allow the air to come out from the tank to the compressor. So this is the purpose of check valve or non-return valve. And tank, obviously it is going to store the compressed air for the future use. So you can also get the backup of the compressed air for some time. When the power fails, it will support the application to come to rest position. So it will take some time. It can store up to some time. So next one, pressure gauge. We allow that we need to monitor the system pressure or the tank pressure. So obviously we are going to have the pressure gauge in it. And one second. And the next one is drain. So in compressor tank, we will have some water getting drained. So we need to remove those water through this auto drain. And 8, this is safety valve. So whenever your pressure switch fails, if you are aware, the pressure switch is the electronic component, so it may get failed. At that time, what is the result? If the switch fails, the compressor may run continuously and the tank may explode. To avoid that, they will also be placing a safety valve, that is valve number 8. So this safety valve will release the excess pressure, like our pressure cooker, which we are using in our kitchen. So that is the best example of a safety valve. The same mechanism is used in the pneumatic compressor also to release the excess pressure in abnormal condition. And dryer, so to emphasize it, our air, atmospheric air consists of oxygen, nitrogen, okay. Apart from that, it is also having H2O, which is the water content. This water content is an enemy or a culprit to our pneumatic system, because all our pneumatic element may get corrupted or corroded with the help of due to this water content. So we need to remove this water content. For that, this air dryer is playing a very vital role. It will remove the water vapor which is available in the atmosphere, compressed air, and it will drain it out. That is the function of the air dryer. And not only water is a big problem, also the dirt particles, because we are going to use the system in the industrial environment, which is obviously dust, having some metal pieces, oil glimpses, everything will be there. All these things to be removed with the help of this line filter or mainline filter. So this is the overall view about the important elements in the air production system. And next part is going to be an air consumption system. Air consumption, we are going to create some movement by using this compressed air. Whatever you watched in the video, we may lift, we may rotate, we may press, we may travel, transport something. So all this movement requires this compressed air to be utilized, and we need some more components. So component number one, which is a piping system. So compressor will not be installed in each and every machines or each and every shop floor. It will be installed in a common area from where we have to transport the air through the pipelines. So that is the first one, distribution system, we can say piping system, which will carry the compressed air to the machine, and the compressed air will enter into the machine crossing this drain valve, because always there will be water vapor present in the compressed air even if it is dried. We cannot remove 100% water from the air. It may be up to some extent only. So some water particles may available in the air, which is again drained in this drain valve, which is marked as number 2. And number 3, which is the receptionist, like a receptionist for the machine. FRL, we will say filter, regulator and lubricator, which will receive the compressed air and it will again filter it for the minute particles. And which will again filter for the minute particles, which is available in the air, and it will also control the pressure. We can set the pressure. So I obviously told only 4 to 6 bar is the pressure, but it need not to be always 6 bar. It can be 5.5 bar, it can be 4.5 bar. So you can set the system pressure with the help of regulator, and lubricator is to mix oil droplets to avoid friction. This is what important parts in the FRL. And next one, direction control valve, which we are going to discuss in detail, which is going to control the movement direction. And the fifth one is the cylinders, or we can say working elements, which is going to push or pull or clamp the objects. So sixth one is flow control valve, which is going to control the speed of movement. If you saw the tipper lorries, it will slowly lift. If you saw the bus lorry, it can open a little bit fast. All these movement speed can be controlled with the help of this flow control valve. Yes. So pneumatic is best suited for a simple design, and it is a small glimpse of real components, whatever we discussed. Air filter, air regulator, and air shutoff valve, that is on and off switch, and you are having a cylinder, and you are having a direction control valve. So this is what the simple component layout of a basic pneumatic system. Yes. Again, which we saw the same only, it is going to be a pick and place operation. So just you can have a look on this video. It's going to pick the box by means of a gripper, and is going to place it in another pallet. For this, you need a gripper, which is going to create vacuum, and it will clamp the box. And we need a linear movement from tower from left to right, and a up down movement is also there. So all these movements are done by a pneumatic cylinder or working element. You can also see the conveyor diverter. It is going to align the box again in conveyor. So it is also going to done by a pneumatic cylinder. You can see the rod extending and going back inside. So this is a small application which is used in the finished product line. After finishing, after packing, all these will be getting aligned in a sequenced manner. For this, we are using pneumatic system here. Okay. So now we are going to discuss about some of the challenges and some of the benefits of using pneumatic system. So again, we can have a small discussion. I open your chat box. Can you say some of the benefits of a pneumatic system, some of the advantage? While you are going with pneumatic system to be used in your application, what can be the benefits? If I'm going to use compressed air to push or pull an object, what could be a benefits? Participants, you can share your suggestions in the chat. Any benefits you may aware, you are aware of that. Pneumatic systems benefits. So I need some suggestions. It's fast, very good. Very good, Ashwin. It's fast. Yeah, comparatively it is fast. Pollution free, good. Because air will not have any abnormal pollutions, clean environment, fine, fantastic, Mr. Prashant. Clean environment. Any other benefits? Since we are going to use compressed air to make automation, sustainable. Okay, sustainable. Yeah, sustainable. It can sustain. It can keep it continue. No hazard. Very good point. Very important point. No hazard, because it is safe compared to oil. You itself told, but it's compared to oil, it is very safe. Fantastic. Fantastic response. Okay, safety, clean, yeah, very important point. India is an economical country, so air is free to use. Economical, easy. The term easy means it is easy to. You can please complete it, Mr. Sridharan. Low cost, yes, it is economical because air is free and easy to find leakage. Yeah, you can use some leakage tester to find leakage. You need some tester also. It is not very much easy to find leakage directly. You need some testers, yes. And okay, fine. Thanks. Thank you for your response. We will have the merits one by one. So the first point, we will discuss about merits. Cheap. Always you are mentioning it is economically cheap because air is available. Air is safe. It is non-explosive and non-toxic compared to your oil or electrical system. You can transmit the compressed air over long distance. You need not to go for a transformer. You need not to go for a wiring sections and all, you can need only the hose pipe to transmit the air, whereas in hydraulic we cannot transmit the air to a long distance, sorry, oil to a long distance. And it can, you can store the compressed air easily, just you need a tank and a safety system that is enough to store the compressed air. But in electricity you need some battery and inverter. And fast in operation, yeah, some of you mentioned it is fast in operation and easy to control the speed. If you compare with the controlling the motor speed, you need some additional electronic circuits to control the motor speed, but here it is very easy for you to control the speed. And clean environment. So most of the points you have mentioned are coming in the merits. Every system will have its merits. Of course, there will be some demerits also. So what are the demerits? The first one we already mentioned, air always have the water vapor, water content, which need to be dried. It is a very important demerits or challenge, you can say. Challenge is a pneumatic system. And next one is, pneumatic system always give the air exhaust. So the pressurized air, after doing the function, it has to go out to the atmosphere. This will create some noise. So it is a noisy system. And with the help of pneumatic system, you cannot go for a huge load applications. You can handle only limited load. You can handle only limited less number of weight, less mass only. So it is an important challenge in the pneumatic system. And smooth movement is not possible compared to the hydraulic oil. Pneumatic system always gives jerky movement only. So it is also a drawback. And it is not accurate. Pneumatic system is not at all accurate, because if you increase the load, automatically the air will be getting compressed, so the movement is not at all accurate. And one more point to add, because I got a question from the chat box during the beginning of the session, what about the efficiency of the pneumatic system, sir? Yeah, pneumatic system is having a very poor efficiency for your information, because the compressor, which is the primary energy source, wastes most of the electrical energy in case of heat, friction and compression. So approximately you can get only to 40 to 50% of efficiency is possible by using pneumatics. So only nowadays we are going to use pneumatics combined with electrical, so that you can reduce or minimize the air consumption. So pneumatic is not a very good efficient system if you compare with hydraulic or other systems. So that is also a one more demerits in pneumatics. So this is what overall view about pneumatics. So now we are going to enter with the next element, which is hydraulics. Hydraulics, yes. One more point we will discuss with Prashant. Mufflers are okay. The chat discussion we'll have at the end of the session. But anyway, good point, Mr. Prashant. So hydraulics. What about hydraulics? Yes, it is also going to do the same mechanical movement. It is also going to have same type of components. But the only difference in hydraulics, it is going to use oil as the medium for developing the power. So in pneumatic, air is the medium, whereas in hydraulic, the oil is the medium. So the picture shown below is giving a basic layout of your hydraulic system. So it is having a fluid tank, which stores the oil, and the filter will take the oil, sorry, the pump will take the oil by creating a vacuum, and this inlet oil to the pump itself filtered to remove sludges in the oil or dust in the oil. Once the pump force the oil to the system, the oil is traveling through a safety valve. You can remember compressor is also having a safety valve. So safety valve, and the safety valve will maintain the required pressure in the system. If the pressure exceeds, immediately the safety valve will return the oil to the tank. So it is called relief valve, we will say normally. And once after that safety valve, you are going to have the oil, which is going to enter into the directional control valve, which is going to shift the direction of movement. And this is your cylinder again, which is going to lift or to push some weight or load. This is the overall view about a basic schematic of hydraulic system. So the same is going to be repeated in the next slide with the detailed component layout. Some of you may be aware of the hydraulic system. So hydraulic system will have a huge force. It can handle a very huge load when compared to the pneumatic system. And these are all the important components in hydraulic, which we discussed in pneumatic, say like a regulator, like filter. In hydraulic also, we are going to have some important components. Component number one, which is your pump, and which is going to push the, which is going to take the oil from the tank. And component number two is your oil tank to store the oil. And component number three is the check valve or non-return valve, because once the pump is stopped after the operation is over, the oil should not enter back to the pump. To avoid that, we are using this component number three, which is a non-return valve. And component number four is your safety valve, which we discussed in the earlier slide, which will maintain the required pressure. If excess pressure came, it will pump back to the tank. Sorry for the interruption. There is some problem with the system. One sec. Okay, so we discussed with hydraulic system structure. We discussed with the direction control valve, which is going to change the direction of your cylinder, and throttle valve is similar to the flow control valve, which is going to control the speed of movement. So it is a small animation or simulation of a hydraulic system where you can point out all the components, pump with some pressure gauge and having some safety valve or relief valve, a direction control valve, and this cylinder which is going to come down and press the application. If you see in the beginning, the pump is getting started, pump is running, and the oil will be pumped into the system. And as long as the valve is not actuated, no changes at all. Once the valve is actuated, see the oil flow into your cylinder, and the cylinder is coming down slowly. Once the cylinder is moving, there will not be any problem. The pressure will not go into high. Once the cylinder stopped its movement, immediately the pressure will shoot up, because oil is stopped means it is going to create a pressure. And at that time, our safety valve will make the excess oil to flow to the tank back. So this is how your basic hydraulic system will work. You can see the pressure drop down because the safety valve released. Again, if the valve changes back to the normal position, that is left side arrow is actuated, the cylinder is going back to the normal position. So the oil will again return to the tank. So all this oil flow that is towards the cylinder and returning back to the tank is controlled by this direction control valves. And the pressure is maintained by this particular safety valve, and you can always monitor the pressure using the pressure gauge. So it is a sample hydraulic press. It's the pressing application which you are seeing in your screen. The cylinder is going to press a job which is placed in the picture. Yes. So with this, we are going to continue with the next slide. So the same, it is a tire industry which is going to treat the tires, tires to get it shaped, and we will call it as a curing operation. So it will give some temperature, the particular rubber to be maintained under some pressure at some temperature for some time. And this is the operation of that. So which is going to, it is a reverse operation. First, the tire is, it is going up. Already a tire is cured. So now another tire will be placed, and again it will come down for pressing. Then another tire is placed in the jig, and again the cylinder is dropping down to apply the required pressure on the tire so that the tire rubber will be treated and it will get cured for the required process. It is a sample application where your hydraulic system is used in the tire industry. Yeah. Again, we are going to discuss something about the demerits and merits of hydraulic system. Similarly, we can have a small discussion on the chat. Can you point out some benefits of hydraulic system? Can you share some benefits? So as of now, we discussed about property of oil and how this hydraulic is used in our daily life and industries. Any major benefit in hydraulic system? Can you share your thoughts in the chat box, participants? Or any major advantage? So many of you shared about pneumatics, not cheap and clean. Yeah, very good. Again, Prashant, high load carrying capacity. It's fantastic, the right answer. Hydraulic can carry a very huge load compared to other systems like pneumatics. Any other option? The hydraulic is high load carrying capacity is having, so that whenever your load exceeds hundreds of kgs, you can go with hydraulics. Any other benefit? Yes, high load carrying capacity. Smooth flow, yeah. Because in pneumatic, it is not smooth, so in hydraulic, it is smooth flow is possible. Right? Kindly mute your audio. Any other benefits? Okay, we will discuss it. Thanks for your suggestion. So merits and demerits. First, we will focus on the merits. The very first important merit is whatever you mentioned in the chat box is right. It is going to carry a very huge load. And the movement is accurate and precise. The hydraulic oil is not compressible, so it can hold the load for a long time. So it is very accurate and precise. Thanks, Ajit Kumar. It is easy to control and accurate. Good point. Yeah, that's what we are going to discuss. So it is very accurate and precise movement is possible in hydraulics, where it is not possible in pneumatics. So it can start up in very heavy load. So the starting torque is naturally high in your hydraulic system, which is not that much in pneumatic system. Even in electrical also, we'll be facing the challenge of starting torque. And smooth movement is possible. One of you mentioned very correctly, smooth movement is very possible in hydraulic system under variable loads. It will have good regulation of speed as well as pressure. Compared to pneumatics, it is having a very good control of speed. And since we are using oil, it itself acts like a coolant or heat dissipating agent in hydraulics. But in industries, based on the location of industries, the oil need to be cooled separately if it is very heat environment. But generally, the oil will have its own capacity to heat dissipate. That is also one more add-on benefit in hydraulic system. And demerits, again, because oil, if it is coming out, it may pollute your environment. So after time of usage, we have to dispose the oil. So that is a big challenge to the environment. So that is one point. And it is sensitive to dirt. Yeah, if oil combined with the dirt or dust, the property will get dehydrated and degraded, and it may cause to a change in viscosity. So if we discuss in detail hydraulic sessions, we will discuss about viscosity for almost 1 to 2 hours. Because if the oil property changes, the cylinder movement will also affect it. And you have to maintain the temperature as well as the purity of the oil as long as possible. That will maintain your system more efficient. So that is the point. Sensitivity to dirt. The oil is always sensitive. And next one, danger. Pneumatic is not that much danger because it is going to operate at very low pressure. But hydraulics, it is danger because you are going to use in excessive pressure. So always you have to follow the procedure perfectly when you are going to work with hydraulic system. And next one. Oil viscosity, which we discussed already. Change in viscosity is a very big problem in hydraulic system. Efficiency is not very constant. Hydraulic system will give you more efficiency also. It may give very less efficiency also based on this property of oil and environment. So it is giving unfavorable efficiency. You cannot predict it to the point. That is a problem with the hydraulic system. So yes, host, I think Mr. Krishna, sir. Are you ready with the poll questions?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can shoot out the first poll question, sir. So in front of you, we'll have some polls. You can answer to the questions. Later, we'll discuss the answer. So you can start with the polling, sir.
Sure, sir. I will take over as the presenter, sir, for a few minutes. I mean, 2 minutes.
Ah, okay. Okay, no problem. Sure. So meanwhile, I will give a summary to them. Yeah, still now we discussed about the basics of automation and what are the important elements in automation. And we focused on two elements, which is pneumatics and hydraulics. And we discussed about important structure or important elements in pneumatic system, start from compressor, and we end with the cylinders. In between, we have some dryers, we have some filters and regulators, we had some direction control valves. And we saw one application video about the pneumatic system, like pick and place and conveying video. After that, we started with the hydraulic system, where we had a hydraulic system structure. The important component is your pump, and again, having tank, it's having a whatever you say, the safety valve plays a very important role, and direction control valves and cylinders. Similarly, hydraulic application also we saw, it is a majorly hydraulic will be used for pressing and lifting only. So we saw a hydraulic pressing application for a tire curing industry, and we discussed about both merits and demerits of these two systems. These are all the short glimpses what we discussed as of now, almost 30 minutes of our session.
I will open
Yes, sir. Yeah, you can answer the questions. Yeah, you're having a poll in your right side. You can select and you can submit it. There are two questions. So which of the below is not a property of pneumatic system? You can click and you can submit the option. Similarly, for the next question, which is the property of the hydraulic system? So these two are the questions. The poll left for you for only 20 seconds. Yeah.
Sir, shall I open it again? Like most of them did not.
Okay. Please open it, sir. Please open it. I think all of you are posting it. The time is increased to 30 seconds. And remember whatever points you discussed and give the correct action. Correct answer.
30 seconds is enough, sir.
Yeah, enough.
Okay, two questions.
Yeah, two questions. Okay. Started. Participants, you can give your answers. You can select the option. First one is a property of pneumatic system. Second question is property of hydraulic system. Okay, sir, we will discuss with the answers. You can keep the polling Thank you, Maishu. Shall we discuss, sir?
Just hold on for a minute, sir.
Okay. Fantastic. So, okay. Some of you have given answer is, yeah. About 13 participants have given correct answers. Some of the limited pressure. Limited pressure is a property of the pneumatic system. Okay, good, good. Question number one is okay. So almost 13% gave the correct answer. And second question, major is getting more answer. 24% gave the correct answer. Yes, high load handling capacity. Okay, sir. Okay, okay, Krishna, sir. Thank you. Thanks for your support. We'll proceed with the presentation, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that is a question we discussed, as you told. Ashwin is correct. Now we are going to discuss in detail about pressure and its basic things. You can have a look on the case. We are going to give a case to you. So I need to lift a load of a 25 kg with a piston diameter of 30 mm. So what is the relation between this piston area? What is piston area and the force and the pressure is? Pressure is equal to force by area. That's what obviously we know. So what is the pressure we require to settle the system to lift this 25 kg load? That is my question here. So you know the formula about force. It is mass into acceleration. If you substitute 25 kg into 10, which is the acceleration due to gravity, constant 9.8. So from this, we are arriving at the solution 250 newton. So my force is 250 newton, which already I have with me. And my area of piston, you know that by d square by 4. If you substitute d is 30, so by 4. Obviously, you are getting the area 0.007 meter square. So you have the two quantities, newton per meter square you are having. If you directly substitute it, you have the solution to 357,143 newton per meter square is the pressure required. But in industry, generally, we won't use this newton per meter square. We will use some commercial units. So from this case study, we are getting the solution that we need some approximately 3.5 lakhs newton per meter square. If you convert it into the commercially used units, so bar, PSA means pounds per square inch, so how can we derive this 357,000 newton per meter square is converted to kilonewton per meter square first, and we are converting it into bar, which is the most commonly used commercial unit in the industry. This 3.5 bar is required. So obviously you can set 4 bar. So considering the friction loss and everything, so the 4 bar is the, you can go up to 4 bar is the pressure requirement for actually lifting this 25 kg cylinder, 25 kg mass with this particular diameter. Now, if I need 250 kg, if I have to lift 250 kg with this type of cylinder, then the pressure requirement will be 35 bar. Same calculation we are going to do. So based on the mass, the pressure can be obtained. So obviously for lower load, you can go for lower pressure, which is pneumatic is sufficient. For higher load, we need to go for higher pressure, which is hydraulic is sufficient. And obviously from this formula, pressure is equal to force by area. If you increase the area, you can use with lesser pressure. If you reduce the area, you need more pressure. So that is what actually the relationship. So in pneumatic, the optimum working pressure is 5 to 6 bar, but in hydraulics, generally it is going up to 700 bar. You can imagine our atmospheric pressure is just 1 bar, and 700 times greater pressure is possible in the hydraulic system, which is extremely danger. And here the pressure is created by reducing the volume of air, but in hydraulic, pressure is created by stopping the flow of oil. So that is the basic comparison between pneumatic and hydraulic system. So just a comparative thing, what are the important elements we are going to use in the form of structure? In pneumatics, the energy supply is compressor. In hydraulic, it is pump. Yes. Next, in pneumatic, the input elements. Input elements means we are going to start a cylinder to move forward, to stop a cylinder to return. So all these things can be started with the help of push buttons. or lever. If you remember, your drivers are the commercial vehicle driver, they will always use to operate a lever in front of them. So lever is one of the input elements, and push button is also an input element. Sensors, automatically it can open and close. So sensor is also the input element. So this is more or less common for both hydraulic and pneumatic, whereas the energy supply is the major difference. Processing element, we can have some logic like only if two hands are operated, only a door should open. Only if a driver and conductor should be acknowledged for the door to open. Like this, if you want to implement some logic, then you need some additional elements, which are called shuttle valves or dual pressure valves or relays, which are used in our pneumatic and hydraulics. And control element, which is a very critical part, which is going to control the direction of movement of the cylinder, forward or reverse, is going to be done by some of the 5x2, 4x2, 3x2 valves. So you may hear about these valves in your projects or in your colleges. So it is also more or less common for the pneumatic and hydraulic, whereas the number is different. In pneumatic, 3 ports, 5 port. Port means connecting points. 3-port or 5-port valve are used in pneumatic, whereas 4-port valve are generally used in hydraulics. And the last part, working element, obviously both the systems are going to have the same type of working element, linear cylinders or rotary motors. So linear cylinder is again single acting or double acting cylinder. Rotary are mainly, it is completely rotationable, or it is like a pendulum clock. Many types are available in the market. So with this, we are going to first focus on the working element, which is the cylinders, which is going to push or pull or lift the object. The first thing is single acting or double acting, which is most widely used in all industries. Very rarely we will use rodless cylinders for transporting materials. And rotary is like I told you, if you remember our tooth grinding, in the dentist, the dental doctors will use the tooth grinding machines. Always they will use pneumatic motors to drain, because it is a teeth, it may not expose to shock. So they will use a minute pneumatic motor. It is a rotary actuator. And in assembly shops, you can see that and pneumatic air guns are available to tight and loose the screws. They are again a rotary actuator. If you remember the earlier video, if you saw, the pick and place operation is done like a clockwise and anti-clockwise movement, like 90 degree movement, 180 degree movement. In that case, we will use a swivel drive cylinder, which is like a pendulum oscillating movement. Those are all coming under rotary actuators. So in this session, we are going to focus only on the single acting cylinder and double acting cylinders. The simulation or animation for a single acting cylinder, you can see it. So the air is applied. Once the air is applied, the cylinder is extending. If the air is released due to the spring action, it is coming back. So normally a cylinder is in the retracted position. Once the air applied, it is moving forward. Again, if the air is released, it is coming back. If you see the second picture in the bottom, always the cylinder is in the extended position. So now I am going to apply the air to retract back. Again, it is a small movement is created with the help of air. Obviously, it can be air or oil based on your pressure requirement, which we discussed earlier. So this is a basic symbol of the single acting cylinder. And double acting cylinder, again, it needs two side pressure application. If you remember, single acting is having spring at one side and air at one side. But in double acting cylinder, both sides you got to give the pressure. So if the pressure is available at the right hand side, there won't be pressure at the left hand side. If you're going to give the pressure at the left hand side, the pressure must be released at the right hand side. You see the animation, you can able to understand. If the pressure is applied, the right hand side pressure is released. Similarly, if the right hand side pressure is applied, left hand side pressure is released. So in technically speaking, the right hand side is called as rod side, and the left hand side is called as piston side. We will say piston side and rod side and the double acting cylinder. So this is a symbol of a double acting cylinder. So very short. Anyway, this time I may continue conduct the quiz, Krishna sir. So you need to go for polling. So participants, you can share your answer in the chat box for time being. So question number one, what is the optimum working pressure in pneumatic system? I'm showing you the options. So please type your suggestion in the chat box now. Optimum working pressure range. Participants, you can use the chat box now. Make it fast. Yeah. Prashant, you're saying option as A. On Suresh, smart Suresh, 10 bar, 5 bar, A, 5 bar. So I'm getting 5 bar as answer, 10 bar, 5 bar. Okay, D, unlimited, okay. 5 bar, A, 5 to 7 bar, 5 bar, 5 bar. Okay, 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 very good, very good, very good. Thanks for your response, thanks for your response. So most of you are suggesting option A, so Obviously, that is the right one because we discussed optimum. Optimum means compatible with cost and size. The recommended pressure is 5 bar. Thank you for your correct answers, all of you. Good. We are going to proceed with the next question. So, which of the following is an example of input element to command to start? Which is the input element example? So, we discussed very, very lightly input element. Just a guess. What can be input element to start a movement? So, Gautam, C, you are suggesting C. Rajalingam, you are suggesting B. Mr. Mutupandi, C. Push button, C, B. Some of you are suggesting B. B is filters. C. Okay, C, D. Rucondal valves. Okay, good, 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 good. Major of you are suggesting with C. Because filter is not an input element. Filter is coming under consumption. It is going to filter the gas only. But whether the operation is going to start or stop, like a switch, which is going to be used now, that is push button only. So many of you are posted correct. That is C. Push button is the right answer. Thank you. Thanks for your response. And in single acting cylinder, the pneumatic pressure is applied at one end only. Is it true or false? In single acting cylinder, pneumatic air or pressure is applied at only one end only. It is true or false? So Prashant, Jodi, Suren, Ajit Kumar, Ajay Saradi, yeah, all of you are saying it's true only. Yes, yes, false. Rajalingam is saying false. Good, good, good. I'm getting mixed up answer. Which could be the right answer? Single acting cylinder. The name saying it's single acting. So the pressure is applied at one end only. The other end it is having spring. So other end there is no need for any pressure. Spring is there. So option is true. Next answer. It's a little bit critic question. If you remember the case study, if pressure is equal to force by area, so if I'm going to increase the area of the cylinder, piston of the cylinder, can I able to handle the high load? So 30 mm cylinder can lift 5 kg means whether the 60 mm cylinder can lift 10 kg. It is true or false? You can give the suggestion. Muralidharan saying true. Yashwant saying false. Abhijit saying false. True. Ajit Kumar is saying true. Vijay is true. Everyone false. 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 Okay. Manoj is saying false. So, if I am going to use small cylinder, I can lift small load. If I am going to use bigger cylinder, I can lift bigger load. Is it right now? So that is what actually the answer true. Because the question is a little bit picky only. Smaller cylinder can lift smaller components. Bigger cylinder can lift bigger components. It is naturally true only. So if the first question is true, second question need not to be false. It is also true. True only. So if you increase the area, you can handle more load. So if you remember the formula, P is equal to F by A. Pressure is equal to force by area. But I am asking about force. Force is equal to pressure into area. The formula will be changing, obviously. So if you are increasing the area, obviously the force will get increased. That is, the load will get increased. So for your information, if the area of piston is increased, you can handle more load. The answer is true. Thanks for your response. So now we are entering into the next part, which is a directional control valves. So obviously we are discussing about changing the direction from forward to reverse or reverse to forward. This can be taken by valves, which is very important in both the system, pneumatic and hydraulic. How these functions, how these valves are going to work, we will see with some animations. So can you have a look on this animation? So you can see, yes, spring is getting compressed and released. Once it is compressed, the number 1 and 2 are getting connected. If it is released, number 2 and 3 are getting connected. It's a cross-sectional view. So from this, you can come to a conclusion. If the spring is pressed, means it's like a push button. I am going to operate it. Once I am operating, the air from 1 is going to 2. If I am releasing the push button, the air from 1 is getting stopped, whereas other 2 ports are getting connected, that is 2 and 3 are getting connected. So this is how your valves will be changing your airflow. So it will change the airflow from 1 to 2, or it is going to change the airflow from 2 to 3. So this is obviously happening inside of your valve. So now we can proceed. And Mr. Rajalingam, sir, I'm coming to your question at the end of the session. Anyway, I will come at the end of the session. In single acting cylinder, input and output are there. So both are only one side only. So that is the actual thing we will be discussing in the end. Yeah. If you see the animation, you'll be able to understand. Yes. Now, there are three ports. One is port 1, port 2, port 3. Both are going to connect with some air pressure only. So REST stage, it is one function is happening. Release stage, another function is happening. Yes. So this is the name of the valve. It is 3x2 valve. We will say 3 means it is having 3 ports. 2 means it is working under 2 conditions. Kindly mute, sir. Kindly mute. Mr. Satyamurthy, please kindly mute. Thank you. So if your valve is operated, so 2 ports are connected. So it is having totally 3 ports and operating in 2 positions. So it is called 3x2 valve. Now, how this valve is going to help in my pneumatic system? We will see with a small video. Yes. If you watch this video, you can be able to understand. The blue color indicates the flow of air, or it can be flow of oil also. How this flow is getting changed, you can see the video. Initially, port A and B, that is port inlet and port B, is connected. If the valve is actuated, port A and port inlet is connected. The number of ports is totally 3. So it is 3 ports, 3 way. And how many positions are there? There are 2 positions, so we have 2. So it is, the name comes 3x2 valve. It is number of ports by number of positions. So initially inlet and B are connected, and if the valve is activated, other 2 ports are getting connected. So now it is a cross-sectional view of your 3x2 valve. So port P stands for pressure inlet, port A stands for application output, port E stands for exhaust return. So the same is converted to symbol here. So P, E and A. If it is operated, okay. If you check the symbol, the bottom side box is showing the normal position and the top side box is showing the actuated position. If the valve is not actuated, initially P is getting closed. If the valve is actuated, P and A are getting connected. So to represent the same, they are using this symbol. Initially, E and A are connected and P is closed. You can see that and you can compare it with the symbol. And once it is getting actuated, P and A are connected and E is getting closed. So this is how the symbol is represented. Now, how this valve is going to operate a cylinder, you can see in the next few seconds. Yes. Okay. Now you can see the from the tank, the pump is getting some fluid. Initially, the fluid is not connected to the cylinder, but the old fluid is going to the tank again. This initial condition. Once if it is operated, the new oil is entering into the cylinder backside, and the cylinder is getting lifted slowly. So now the cylinder is getting lifted. And again, if the valve is released, it is directly exposed to the tank. So the spring will compress and the old oil will go back to the tank. So this is how this 3x2 valve is going to control your cylinder movement, up and down movement or forward and reverse movement. So this is how the valve and cylinder is getting connected in the pneumatics as well as in hydraulics. The same is represented in the simulation here. So these are all the valves getting connected and being operated. Once 2 valves are finished, I will show you a simulation so that you can easily understand that. Next one is 4 ports valve. Here, earlier we discussed only about 3 ports, that is P, E and A. Here you are having more than then, you are having P, A, B and T. So here we have 2 application ports A and B, and 1 return port, exhaust port T, and 1 pressure inlet port P. Obviously, there are 4 ports, so it is going to be named as 4x2 valve. So this is what is going to happen, and it is a working simulation for this 4x2 valve. You can see the symbol in the right side and the cross-sectional view in the left side, and there's a double acting cylinder. In this case, the cylinder is having 2 input. One is in the bottom, another one is in the top. So this valve will supply oil to bottom or top by changing the position. Now it is operated, so it is going to be come down. If it is released, it is going to up. So now the oil flow is in the 2 directions. So it is having 2 output port. So if you see this, the red color indicates the high pressure line and the blue color indicates the low pressure line. Low pressure means the blue color line is directly going to the tank. It is going back to the tank, which is a settled down condition, no pressure. But the red color having high pressure, it is going to be operating the cylinder. So this is the small simulation about this video. So once the pressure is reached, the excess pressure is traveling back to the oil tank with the help of this safety valve. I am repeating it once again. If you are seeing, if it is operating, the cylinder is coming down. If you are releasing, the cylinder is going up. So the direction of movement is changed with the help of this direction control valve. So this is how the two output valve will function. Okay. So again, this is a simulation of these two things. And third one, one more port is added, five ports. That is port number one, or it can be an input port. 2 and 4 is the output, 3 and 5 is the exhaust, we will say. So two output ports, two exhaust port. This is also available in the market. So this valve is called as 5/2 way valve, which is having two exhaust, two output and one input. Summarizing again, 3/2 valve has one input, one output, one exhaust. 4/2 valve have one input, two output, one exhaust. Here it is having one input, two output, two exhaust. So based on the application, you can choose the valves. Based on the requirement, you can choose the valve. If you see here, there is a spool, there is a cylinder rod moving left and right. It is moving left and right. So each position, any two ports are connected. One and two are connected. At the same time, four and five are connected. Other condition, one and four are connected. At the same time, two and three are connected. So you can able to visualize, I think. So this is how these two ports are getting shifted continuously in case of 5/2 valve. So with this, we are going to see the simulation of all the three valves working. So I'm going to change the screen for the simulation window. Kindly bear with me for a minute. Yes, now we are going to change the screen. Okay, I think you can see the window now. I'm going to open a file. 3/2 valve. If you saw this, again, we are having a 3/2 valve controlling the single acting cylinder. The blue color line indicates the compressed air waiting at the port number one, and port number three is the return to atmosphere, and two is the output for the cylinder input. Normal condition, the cylinder is not operating, there is no velocity. If the valve is getting operated, the cylinder is moving forward, holding the pressure inside. So now one and two are connected, port number three is blocked. If you release the hand from the push button, again, 2 and 3 are connected, 1 is getting blocked. So for slower motion, you can check it. Little bit you can see it. Okay. So, okay, no problem, it's a little bit fast only. Okay. It is extended and it is getting released. So only one input for the cylinder. So it is going, it is entering into the input, compressing the spring. Once the push button is released, the spring is pushing back the cylinder to the normal position. This is how your single acting cylinder will be controlled by the 3/2 valve. Now we are going to check with the double acting cylinder how they are getting controlled. Same simulation. I'm going to use a 4/2 valve, which we saw in the earlier slide. So it is a 4/2 valve. We're having double acting cylinder, which is having input, two inputs, one is on the piston side, one is on the rod side. As long as the valve is not operated, what is the position of the cylinder? You can see, yes, the cylinder normally extends. The valve is not operated, but port number one and four are connected. The cylinder is going forward automatically. If the pressure, if the valve is operated, the cylinder is coming back to the normal position. You can see the port is changed. One and two are connected, four and three are connected. If you release the hand, again, it is coming back to the normal position. So like this, this double acting cylinder requires two output ports. So we are using 4/2 valve to control this double acting cylinder. And the port number three is just for exhausting the air to the atmosphere. So this is how this 4/2 valve is used to control the movement of the cylinder. Similarly, 5/2 valve, which is again, you can use, you can see the difference. If you saw the two circuits, You can see the port number 4, output port number 4 and 2 is connected with these cylinders. But what is the difference between the left hand side circuit and right hand side circuit is 4 and 2 are swapped. So how this circuit is going to function, you can see now in the screen. So left side, it is in the home position or in the retracted position, but right side it is extended immediately. So if your project needs right hand side condition, you can use right hand side circuit, or left hand means left hand side circuit you can use. I am operating it now. Once the valve is operated, the left side circuit is operating now. The cylinder is moving forward. If I release it, the cylinder will come back. The same, if right side is working in the ulta basis, if I am pressing, it is coming back. If I am releasing, it is going forward. So with this valve and cylinder, you can do any magics, whatever your requirement, based on that, you can use the circuit for your working. So this is how these valves are going to contribute in your automation system. Yes, now I'm going back to this slide. Okay. Excuse me. Sir, I'm facing some difficulty in sharing your screen. Just a second. For me to share the screen, I think Mr. Krishna sir, any control is there to share it?
What do you want to share, sir?
I'm just trying for sharing, but it is not responding for me as of now. It's shared. One second. Just a minute. Sorry for the interruption. There's some problem in sharing in the screen. I can't able to share. Okay. I think the simulation is now shared to you again. One second. It's taking some time to share. There is a problem. Sorry. Okay. Fine. So we ended up with, host Mr. Krishna sir, it is visible. Screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks for the feedback. Fine. So we ended up with the 5x12 simulation. We saw that in the software. So these are all some of the glimpses about direction control valves. You can operate the valve with the help of a push button, with the help of lever, with the help of foot pedal. If you remember, some of you remember CNC machines, you can operate the CNC machine with the help of foot pedal also. That is also one way of actuation. You can also operate the valve with the help of limit switches. In most of the conveyors, they will use to detect the presence of object using limit switches. That is what roller. If you see here, it is a roller operated valve. So it is a limit switch based type. And you can also actuate the valve using pneumatic pressure itself. You can also apply the air pressure to push the spool or push the push button. That is also possible. It is a pneumatic actuation. And you can also operate the valve with the help of coil, electromagnetic mechanisms you can use to operate it. That is what electrically actuated valve. So these four types of actuations are possible in all the direction control valves, both in pneumatics as well as in hydraulics. So you have to choose which type of actuation is required based on our application required. So it is a very short quiz. We will have a quiz again in the chat box itself. So first one, which valve can be used to control single acting cylinder? So out of these four, which is the correct choice? Anyone? Yeah, somebody from participant side? So B, option B. B. Thank you, Vignesh Subramaniam. Thank you, Jyothi. So Jyothi and suggesting B. Ashwin suggesting B. Sridhanu suggesting B. So most of the participants are suggesting B, obviously, because single acting cylinder need only one input. So your 3/2 valve is having only one output. So these both are the couples. Thank you for your correct response. The option is B. Fantastic. Yeah. Now again, please remember which of the valve will have one return line and two output line. Which of the valve will have one return line and two output line? Most of us are suggesting B, 5/2, 5 ports. Some Vignesh Subramani is suggesting 4/2. Thank you. Thanks for your response. 4/2, B or D. Obviously, A and C is not in picture because they are not at all supported. The competition is between B and D only. Whether B is right or D is right. Mixed up answers are coming. If you remember, yeah, now I'm getting most of D is the right answer. Yes, because 5/2 valve will have two return ports and two output ports, totally 5 ports. Only 4/2 have only one return port and two output port. The answer is right, D. Thank you for your response. Thanks. So, sir, okay, what about the scope in industries? I am going to learn about this pneumatic and hydraulic and automation, okay. But what is the scope in industries? Where these are getting used? Initially, in the first slide, we discussed about the applications, pick and place, conveyor, storage, etc. Confined to the industry perspective. So using this system, you can create new automation in your existing machines. In industries, you will be obviously working with the shop floor. In existing machines, you can improve some automation by using this pneumatic and hydraulic mechanism, which will have most warm welcome in the industries. They require some creativity from among your young engineers. And you can do preventive maintenance, because most of our persons are used to do my machine concept, that is my machine, I will maintain. So every person in the industry need to have some basic knowledge on preventive maintenance. For that, you need to have this pneumatic and hydraulic knowledge. And mistake proof, some of you may have heard this term, Pokayoke, it's a mistake proof. So to improve your quality, to improve your cycle time, you may do some fast mechanism, some mistake proof system. So in that mistake proof system, I can ensure you that 70% of mistake proof system needs some pneumatic or hydraulic operations. And if you want to create your own automated machine, compulsory, you require this pneumatic and hydraulic knowledge. Okay, sir, all these operations are required pneumatic and hydraulic knowledge, but where they are used, in which department? Yes, obviously in industry, you are having many departments like accounts, HR, finance, non-technical and technical department. You have maintenance, production, plant engineering, design. Obviously, all these four departments need these type of knowledges infrequent. So this is the input from my experience with the industries. So if you are going in any one of these department in industries, you will have this basic knowledge with the pneumatic and hydraulic knowledge. Yes, now we are coming to the end of this session. We are going to discuss some applications, how these pneumatic and hydraulics are used in industries. So I am going to show you the first case study, which we just get from some of our industries. So case study number one, it is a valve to be opened and closed. It is not like a very easy valve, it is a little bit heavier valve. Where you operate need to open and close this valve with his hand. So after some time, what happening? He is getting tired. He is getting fatigued. So because of that, after 4 hours, he can't able to work as in the morning or as in the earlier sessions. So we have to suggest a automation for it. So what is the problem here? So the operator is getting tired. The operator is getting fatigued. So because of that, obviously the productivity is getting increased because the performance will be down. So this valve opening and closing is a regular job which is doing again and again. He may feel some tiredness. So to overcome that, we need a simple automation for this application. How we can implement the simple automation is, first we have to determine which function to automate in this case study. The option is the valve need to be opened and closed. So that is the automation required. Opening and closing of this pipeline with the help of a valve. So what I am going to do, I am going to couple this valve with this cylinder, so double acting cylinder. So this cylinder can move forward and reverse so that it can operate this valve. For operating a cylinder, the operator can just press a push button, that is enough. So instead of opening and closing the valve manually, if he is going to operate a push button and the cylinder is going to push and pull the valve, so it is a simple automation which you can implement. As a result, you can improve the productivity also. So what are the components required? You need a cylinder, obviously, to push. So next, you need some direction control valve to operate the cylinder. and you need some push button elements to operate the 5x2 valve. So these are all the list of components which is required. And here it is a picture of those components: cylinders, push buttons, foot pedal. Because the operator need not to use always the hand, he can also use the foot pedal, so that again the fatigue is much reduced. We are giving choice to the operator. So with this, it is a connection diagram. So obviously you will have the FRL unit, and you will have the cylinder, and you will have the direction control valve, which is double acting cylinder. So obviously 5x2 or 4x2 valve you can use, and you are having push button valve, and you are having foot pedal valve, and you are having one more additional valve, which is logical element shuttle valve, we will say. So with the help of these components, you are going to give the connections like this, and this valve will operate the cylinder forward and reverse. Now the operator can press either push button or foot pedal so that the cylinder will move forward. The cylinder is moving forward, obviously the valve is getting opened and closed automatically. It is a simple automation. So this is the circuit connection, which we will see in the later simulations. I will show you all the simulations at one time. This is the next case application where you need to lift a heavy metal from the tank. So you can see a cylinder mounted vertically. This up down and operation can be controlled with the help of a pneumatic circuit. So the rising and lowering of cylinder is controlled by manual push button. So imagine this condition: if the cylinder is in the bottom side, the ladle will be in the lifted position. If the cylinder is getting up, the ladle will go down and it will take the liquid metal and it will pour into the basin. So this automation requires the cylinder to move up and down. So the up movement is controlled by the operator. The operator will press a push button, he will stand alone, the cylinder will move up. After reaching the up position, up end position, the cylinder will automatically come down. This is a small type of automation. For this, what we require, again, we require a, what is the function to automate here is, just we need to lift and lower this cylinder. For this, we need push button and sensor. Push button is to start and sensor is to return back the cylinder. So these are the list of components. We need some push button valve, we need some sensor, roller sensor, we need some speed control valve, and we need a double acting cylinder, and we need a 5x2 direction control valve. And this is the photos of your component, and this is the end simulation. So we can have a look on this two simulations in the software. Meanwhile, we will come back to this slide. Just hold a minute. There is some problem with this sharing only, I think so. Taking some time to share. Yes, I think you got the share now. Fine. Just we can discuss those two case studies. First case study is just we have to operate a cylinder with the help of a push button or foot pedal. This is the option required. So we are having two options here, push button and foot pedal, and the cylinder is now in the home position. Now we are going to operate the circuit. So initially cylinder is in the retracted position. Now if the operator is pressing the push button, the cylinder is getting for moving forward, opening the valve. As long as the push button is pressed, the valve is open. If the operator releases his hand from the push button, the cylinder will come back to the home position. Similarly, he can also use foot pedal to operate the cylinder. So either or choice, he can use the push button or foot pedal to operate this cylinder. So this is what the case study told us. So the operator fatigueness is reduced. And next case study, obviously, it is a lifting and lowering of the cylinder. So if you see this, again. The cylinder is mounted vertically. Initially, the cylinder is in the bottom position only. Once the operator is operating the push button, the cylinder moves up and reaching up, it is getting down automatically. Make it small. I'm just going for a reduction factor. Yes, so I am just adjusting the flow control just to show you brief slow motion. I am reducing the speed of the cylinder. It is very easy in adjusting the parameters in the simulation.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Now we can operate. Once the cylinder is operated, it is going up. Sorry, I reduced the speed very much. The cylinder is moving up for carrying the metal. Once the cylinder reaches the end, it will be it is pressing the particular pneumatic sensor, which is at the top. Once the sensor is pressed, again, the cylinder will come down automatically. Now it is going to actuate it. Yes, it is actuating so that it is coming down after taking the metal. So this is a small automation where we require some direction control valve and some flow control valve to control this motion of the cylinder up and down. Yes, so now we are almost in the final part. So one more last case study. With this, we'll wind up the session. I will time for discussion. Again, I'm going to stop the share. Kindly bear with me. Okay, it came immediately. But so, yes, all this we discussed. Now, I am going to give you a very, very, very interesting problem in industry. It is a real, real situation. If you imagine this inspection system, it is a food industry which is going to pack some cans. So the cans are going away from the industry without lead. That is a problem here. It is a conveyor with 50 meters length, and 20,000 cans need to be inspected in one every 4 hours. That is, in 8 hours, you may have to inspect 40,000 cans. And we are having some 3 to 4 manpower to inspect that. Even they are inspecting each and every day, they are getting at least 50 cans defected, at least 50 defective cans per day because of the manual error. And each defective can, the customer is going to charge. That is, the person who is getting the can going to give penalty of almost 2 times of the can. It is almost 10 rupees. So if you calculate, each day 50 defective can with the 10 rupee penalty means it is going up to 15,000 per month. That is a problem. That is a loss. Also, the name of the company may get down because of this quality failure. So we have to implement the automation. So that, what is the automation here? Can without lead must be removed from the conveyor. That is the automation required. So if the can is not available, lid is not available, the can must be ejected out from the conveyor. If can and lid are available, it can be okay piece. So this need to be done automatically. What can we do? We have to implement some automation here. So what are the material required in this case? Here we need some sensor. Now it is not a pneumatic sensor, not a roller sensor. We need some electrical sensor to sense, like photoelectric sensor, which we are using in our wash basins and lift door. And we need to detect the cylinder is extended completely to push the can. For that, we need some sensor. To control the sensor, we need some electrical component like relays. And obviously, since we are going to use this electrical sensor and we are going to use the electrical relays, we have to operate the valve also by electrical only. So we need some solenoid valve, and the direction, the double acting cylinder is not going to change. It is a normal double acting cylinder only. So now we need to interact this pneumatic circuit with electrical components. So obviously it is a hybrid system, which we discussed in the first slide. We can use electrical plus pneumatic, which is called electro-pneumatic system. So since sensors and solenoids are coming in picture, it is a electrical plus pneumatics, which is electro-pneumatics. So most of the industries use motors. 70% of the load is motor only. Remaining 22% we will be using solenoid coil or solenoid valves only. So in our case, we are going to use solenoid valve as our control element, direction control element. Yes. So mostly used are push buttons and proximity sensors. Control part is limit switches. So this is the list of components again. Okay. So in this case, If you remember this, I am using one 5-port valve to control double acting cylinder, but this time the valve is going to be operated with the help of solenoids, both sides. So I need one more additional circuit, which is a electrical circuit to control this cylinder movement. So we need both type of circuits, we need both applications. And how this is going to operate, we will see with the simulation, and almost that will be the end of our session. So last I'm going to share a screen, the simulation. Take some time to share. I can't able to share it, it's getting some delays there. Any provisions, sir? Need to share, any permission is there to share? Nothing, no? Intermediate, I'm facing this problem in sharing this thing. Okay, at last is shared. Thank you. Thank God. Okay, sir, it is shared. We are going to see the case study. Final case study of us. Okay. This is the both circuits where your cylinder is going to be the working element, and the forward and reverse movement is controlled by the solenoid operated valve, and the electrical part is in your right hand side. You are having two sensors, one is scan sensor, another one is lit sensor, which is like a proximity sensor only. You having a top, you are having 24 volt DC, in the bottom you are having 0 volt DC, which is getting connected with the sensors. So start with the simulation. So just for understanding, initially the lid and can both are available, that is red color indicates they are giving output. If both the sensors are on, there is no action, nothing is there. If the lid is not available, immediately the cylinder will come forward, it will push away the can. Once the can fall down, the can sensor will also go off, so immediately the cylinder will going back. Repeating again, if both lid and can are present, there is no problem, it is a good can, it can go off the conveyor, it can continue with the conveyor. If there is no lid, then immediately the cylinder will come forward and it push off the bottle and the cylinder will go back to the home position. So this is how your pneumatic is used for inspection system also. You can replace or you can eject the faulty parts from the conveyor. You can pick and place the faulty parts from conveyor. All are possible with the help of the system. It's a small case. So once you implemented it, there is no chance for any defective cans going to the customer end. So this is what a small introduction about how this pneumatic or hydraulic system is used as an automation tool in industry. Again, coming back to this slide. So is the slide is visible, sir? Krishna, sir? Krishna, sir? Host? Sir, host, sir? Slide is visible? Okay, fine. So this is how we're going to use these systems, and to end up with, in case, as of now, we discussed with the as of now, we discussed with only one cylinder operation. In future, if you are going for two cylinders or three cylinders to be controlled, we may have a lot of checkpoints. I think the slide is visible or simulation is visible for you. Anyone is acknowledged?
Simulation, sir.
Okay, fine, understand. Okay, sir. I will stop the share and I will come back. Okay, meanwhile, yes, suppose if you have, if you are going to operate with two cylinders like this, in case of clamping as well as milling, clamping as well as pushing, like that two operations are required, then you may have to check lot of options. So some of the hints for you, if I am going to do a job, or a job need to be clamped and drilled, and you can imagine the situation, one cylinder has to clamp, one cylinder has to drill. So I have to check all these functions to automate clamping of job, and then milling or drilling of job, that need to be a horizontal movement and vertical movement, both need to be controlled. So it is a little bit complicated. So what are the checkpoints I have to ensure? I have to ensure whether the job to be drilled must be present, and the clamping pressure must be reached. So I need a pressure sensor, and cylinders must be in the end starting position or in the end position, that need to be sensed, and operator must press two hands to ensure safety. To all these parameters to be considered, and we need to have the timers, we need to have a number of jobs still, we can take counters in case of emergency, we have to stop the operation. So what is the conclusion? If you are going to improve these operations in industries, we may have more and more checkpoints. So we need to go for prioritization, we need to go for complete automation. In that case, you may have logical, you may have sequencing, you may have time based operation, you may have count based operation. You need to prioritize the movement, and all these can be easily done with the help of PLC control also. So you are having PLC, obviously you may know that it's industrial computer, which may have input, which may have output, and which is going to control the operation with the help of a program. Here the input is, as usual, our pneumatic based push buttons, our proximity sensors only, and output is our relays or our solenoid valve only, and our cylinder is going to operate only, but the brain is PLC. So again, it is a hybrid system. So PLC combined with electrical, combined with pneumatics or hydraulic system. This is what the trend in today's industry, hybrid system, blending of more than one technology so that each system advantage can be taken into consideration. So when your automation is getting more and more tricky, you can go with more number of hybrid system, combined pneumatics or hydraulic combined with electrical system, including PLC. This is today's scenario in all the industries. With this, we are going to have this session stopped or concluding. So it's time for your queries and doubts. So you can share all your queries, whatever your doubts. You can have your chat box discussion. So meanwhile, I will summarize the entire session. So you can type your queries in the chat box. So we discussed about pneumatic system, pneumatic structure. We discussed about hydraulic system and hydraulic system structure, and we discussed some important components like direction control valves and cylinders. And we, with that components, how they are controlled, we saw some simulations, and we took some two case studies. One is for opening and closing a heavy valve, and another one is to just lift a cylinder, and the final one is to inspect. So these are some of the examples we are going to use in the industries. And we show the simulations for that also, how these cylinders are getting controlled with the valves. And this is the overall view. And we also discussed about the scope for pneumatics and hydraulics industries also. What are the departments may require this technical knowledge in this? We discussed about that also. This is the overall session we had, and how pneumatics and hydraulics are used in automation. We had the discussion. So now it's time for your queries. If you have any doubt regarding this pneumatic and hydraulics or in this session, you can have a discussion. Please type your doubts or your queries in the chat box. We are here to answer your queries.